Let's look at your first SPSS assignment, and just for everybody viewing, this is how to run descriptive statistics using syntax, but you don't have to use syntax to do this, but I'd like you to use syntax. So there is an additional video that shows you how to do it without syntax. Syntax is just more efficient when you're dealing with larger data sets. All right, so let's look at the assignment. Your first assignment is to produce descriptive statistics and figures using the assigned data set. It's called myfirstdataset.sav. This obviously means to download the data set. Again, you can't download it if you don't have SPSS. You will complete a descriptive statistics table and add figures to the assignment worksheet. You have to download this assignment worksheet. I'll show it to you in a second. Note that you will produce histograms. So this is important, because I've seen assignments come in without this, and that's not good. Note that you will produce histograms for each of the quantitative interval ratio variables, or if you want to call it a continuous variable, whatever you use. I'll be mentioning in lectures that people use these interchangeably, these terms, and bar charts for each of the categorical variables. Those are either ordinal or binary. The figures will be copied and pasted directly from SPSS, just the figures, nothing else, okay, just the figures, into the Word document following the appropriate figure title, and I'll show you that in a second. The videos explain how to compute descriptive statistics. That's a different piece right there. So that's the original video that shows you how to do it without using code. So I'll upload that separately if you'd like to use that. Please look at the code sheet and show you that as well. So I have to download the code sheet. So let's click that and download that. But here's the code sheet. So I'm going to cover everything briefly. So let's get started. All right, so code means typing in syntax. So when we talk about the code for a specific type of analysis, we need to add syntax. To start, we need our data set. So our data set is called myfirstdataset.sav. Again, that's a data set in SPSS. So if you download that, again, if you have SPSS, you'll download your data set. Make sure you save it somewhere where you can have access to it readily, because we're going to use it in our syntax, right? So here's the data set. It's all set up. So I'm going to go to our, just to show you what I did, to find where I downloaded it. So I put it in, this is the download, so I don't want to go there. I got to find actually where I have it. I think I have it in here. Let's see. Oh, I have it under data. Data set. Assignment one. That's my file. Let's just download it and I'll show you what it did. So I just downloaded this. Now I'm going to save it somewhere. So it's a file. Save as. Let's see. Oh, here. I saved it under HSC 217 for this. That's our course for this semester. So I found a place and I saved it. Here it is, right? If I say save, it'll tell me to replace it. Yes, I replaced it. Okay, so now I know where it is. All right, let's go back to finding the address. And let's see. I go under my H, there it is. I see it. Under my this file, it's in OneDrive. I have my own address for it. Okay, so if I right-click that file, right-click it. Again, this is for people who use Windows. I'm not a Mac person, so if you're using Mac, you just need to find similar information for what's the address of your file. So my file is under C users Rodriguez D OneDrive. So I have this whole address. I copy this address. Notice that in this Windows system, I have the file name and then I have the address. Those are separate, right? File name is not the same as the address. So I find this long address here, I copy it, and then I put it in my syntax file. You already have a video that shows you how we create these syntax files, and if you haven't watched it yet, please watch that. So what I do is when I set up a syntax file, I'll start by having this, for when I set it up for you, I'll start by having the word address here. So you replace this word with the actual address. And before I do that, notice that there's a slash here. I guess that's a backslash, I think. So, and following that is the dataset name .sav, so telling what type it is, and it's within this single quotation mark. And I paste it. So this will tell me to get that file, right? So retrieve that file. This is equivalent of double-clicking your file wherever it is. So if you were to double-click your file from whatever folder you keep it in, and you look at the output, you'll get a get file, like something like this, okay? So track using this information is a great way to learn syntax. Because it actually, the syntax is always printed out for you by SPSS. So you can actually learn coding by looking at the output. All right, so I have this, and I already have this file open, so it's just going to tell me that the file's already open. But I want to highlight this. Yes, it says, warning, warning, get file, the document is already in use by another. It's me, right? I'm using it already, so it's just telling me that it. Some cases it'll either overwrite it or it'll change the name of it. So you got to look at that. So if you look at this here, you have the original file that was already open, but you also have an untitled file too, which is the same file because there was contention for the same file. So I'm just going to close this one. Okay. So this is the original file we have open. All right. So now we need to run syntax. In this document here, I show you what we have to do. Now, in a previous video, I showed you how to write syntax to modify your files. So you need to know how to do that. In this video, I'm showing you how to run some commands. So these commands are for what you need for the assignment, because we need frequencies with bar charts for the discrete variables, and then we need means and standard deviations and histograms for the continuous, quantitative, whatever you want to call them, variables. Okay, so these are the actual commands you run. So let's start by, well, we'll start by running these, but let me actually step back and go over the assignment for a second again. So in the assignment, you are asked to complete this table. So this is your prototypical descriptive statistics table that you see at any research journal article. So for the discrete variables, you'll have the variable name and you'll have the categories, so the levels. N stands for how many individuals there are, and percentage, what percentage is. The percentage must add up to 100% because you're accounting for everybody. So these are the variables that we'll be doing, or you'll be doing in your assignment. Sex, free or low cost lunch, past 30-day alcohol use, past 30-day smoking. These will be variables that you will find within this data set. And then there are these quantitative continuous variables: age, body mass index, number of peers smoking, perceived physical appearance, self-esteem, and depression. At the bottom, you have room for your figures. So you're going to copy and paste the figures out of SPSS right into these areas here. So I'll do one of each type for you, okay? So that's what we'll do today, and we'll be doing it with syntax. So first one, let's do a discrete variable. And let's start with sex. So this is free for you. You got part of your assignment done. Isn't that awesome? All right, so the code we need is this. Using the frequencies command. So I'm going to put it right under here. And it lights up because I did everything right. The only thing I didn't do is put the variable name. So I need to know what the variable name is here. This is where I can just go straight to my data set. And see, I set this data set up really nicely. So you have labels for everything. You have the code written out. For instance, here, female is 0, male is 1. And I set it up as a nominal variable. In the last video, I showed you how to do this. the code sheet that I pulled up earlier just gives you information about what the variables are. So you use the code sheet to set up the data set. And if somebody didn't do a really good job setting up the data set, you can use the code sheet to see what variables you have. Like, we know sex is 0 is female, 1 is male, and it's a nominal variable, right? It's a nominal type of discrete variable. So all the code are written here. So you should always have a code sheet for every type of variable you're using in a data set. And if you're assigned by somebody to create a data set for your job or for some researcher, you need to prepare a code sheet as well. Because this will allow other individuals to do your work. If you're sick one day, or if you quit the job and leave or whatever, that somebody else can pick it up from what you did, and the researcher can see if you did a good job. All right, let's go to this. So we're going to do this for the variable sex, which is named sex, right? As long as there's one data set open, as long as there's just one data set open, this command will work for that data set. So I opened one data set. If I hover over my SPSS tab, I see that there's only one data set open. Okay, if I had two data sets open, I have to make sure that the last data set I clicked onto is active. I would generally delete the other ones, or close the other ones, I should say, so I don't have access to them anymore. So we're going to go ahead and run this command. So I'm going to highlight this, and I'll show you later how we can get around having to highlight all the time. Because this is all I want to run. I don't need to run the get file anymore. My file is there. So this is a frequency command. The frequency command has to tell me which variables I'm using. The variable I'm using is sex. If I had more than one, I could list them all out. And the subcommand is, I want a bar chart and I want frequencies. Okay, so let's click the green arrow. And this should work. Here it is. So here's the output. We have, this information just gives you how many individuals you have data on. So there's 389 individuals we have data on, 4 missing cases. What that means is these individuals, either we don't have their sex, for some reason we don't have their sex, but I don't know what it is. Maybe they didn't fill it out or whatever. You'll get this frequency table. You need to know how to read one of these frequency tables. The N is the frequency. So there's 176 females, 213 males, right? For a total. So N generally refers to the total, 389, right? There's 2 different percentages here. We use the valid percent. Now, this percentage isn't invalid, but it also includes what percentage are missing, and that's not what we're interested in. We want to know what the percentage of individuals for whom we have data are for each of the levels. The cumulative percent is the cumulative distribution. So you just accumulate up to 100%. So 452.2 plus 54.8 equals 100%. Here is our bar chart. So there's 2 separate bars, just showing you what the frequency is. You could change this to proportion, but that's up to you. You can actually double click these guys and do a lot of work within them. So you can make some changes if you like. So for instance, you might want this, I think you can go like this, and yep, so you change it. It's orientation, trend lines don't make sense here. So some of these don't make sense. You know, you're able to do a lot of extra stuff with this. Like, you can edit it and, I don't know, let's see, do whatever you want with it, add elements to it. And a lot of these won't make sense for a bar chart, but they make for other types of charts. So you can play around with, change colors, whatever. What I want you to do is, I want you to copy this and place it in the paper right where it says bar chart for sex. Okay, so now we have bar chart for sex, and there it is. Now you can work it out so this says 1 here, so you can continue with this numbering. You can play around with that, okay? As long as you have them all, that's all I care about. Okay? I would put the frequencies in here, right? So we had, let's split the screen. Okay, here we have females was N is 176, in males, the N is 213, right? The proportion we have, proportion of males is 54.2, and for females, it's whatever it is, 54.9. I used the wrong one. Aha. You can get me for that, right? 54.8, because we're using the valid percent, and 45.2 for females. So that's how you'd complete that part. So for the variable sex, everything is done now, okay? Let's move on to a continuous variable example. Okay, here you have two different options to run a continuous variable. You can use either the descriptives command or the examine command. They are different. Descriptives command just gives you the means and standard deviations without the charts. The examine command, you can get the charts as well. So I'd like the charts because that's part of the job. So I'd probably use the examine command, but we'll use both of them here. So let's go ahead. You notice, by the way, in this syntax, I actually have these little asterisks. That this is a way to talk to identify a note in SPSS. So you'll notice when I copy and paste this into my syntax file, these notes will get like lighter. They're highlighted. They're the font color is like a light gray. So that means these are notes. So sometimes you want to put notes in your command in your syntax. I have syntax that has thousands and thousands of lines to it, 50,000 lines. So I need these notes to remind me what I'm doing. I just would save my syntax every once in a while to make sure I don't lose anything. Syntax is more important than the data. With the exception of the first data set, the syntax is the most important element you have because this will always regenerate data sets. So you don't have to save a million data sets. You just have to save the parent data set. All right, so let's run a descriptives let me pick one of the items for you. See, if we were in class together in person, I would say, hey, which one do you want? But I'll do this for you here just so you can see it. Let's do age. All right. Let's do the first one. Age. All right. So let's run that. Now here's another little interesting piece. Let's see how I can do this. Okay. I don't want to run the whole thing again. I don't want to run the frequency command. So I'm placing my cursor here. And I'm going to take this little, I'm just going to click right here in front of the line following the command I want to run. And there's this red dot shows up. So now if I go to run, I can say run to the end. And this will run from where the placement of my cursor to that red dot. And that comes in handy when you have thousands of lines of data, lines of commands, and you just want to run a snippet of it. All right, so this is all that you get. You get the mean and the standard deviation. We're covering what those are, but you get the mean and the standard deviation. Mean is the average, and the standard deviation is the spread. I could run it with the more comprehensive command, examine command, to get more of what I need. Here I ask for a plot. I ask for something called a box plot. I'll talk about that. A histogram. I won't talk about it in this video, but in class I'll talk about this. I want the descriptive statistics. Confidence interval, we'll be dealing with that. And list-wise, what happens is data are erased whenever there's a missing case for that individual. So if there's multiple variables, that individual will lose all cases. That's all that's saying. So now, again, I could use whatever I want, but since it's only one command, I will highlight and hit the green arrow. So this is, as you can see, is much more comprehensive. You get means, you get confidence intervals, you get these trimmed means, you get medians, variance, standard deviation, minimum, max, a whole bunch of good stuff here. A lot of which don't make any sense yet because we haven't even talked about them. But I do get a histogram. And, the histogram even prints the mean and the standard deviation with it. So I got everything I need right here. So I'm going to take that mean. It's 15 points. So let's split the screen again. For age, so mean is 15.73. and the standard deviation is 0.583. Whenever you have you start with a value less than one, you always start with 0.583. I like three decimal places. If I have them, I use them. Here I only get two, so I'll just use the two. But I like three decimal places. And I need the figure. I'm going to copy this figure. And I'll paste it after where it says age, wherever that is. Histogram for adolescent age, right here. And age is done. So that's all you have to do for this assignment. All right, so that's how you run it using syntax. You can watch the other video, which I'll give you access to show you how to run it using the drop-down tab. I wanted to do syntax here. In this video, if you want to use a drop-down tab, fine, but you have to understand the syntax. All right, that's all, folks.